Everybody's had what they want for lunch, hopefully. If they haven't had what they want for lunch, they can have what they want for dinner, hopefully. And they'll certainly get for the afternoon and into the evening all the intellectual and emotional requirements met that they came here with. And I just realized that there's a cameraman in back. I didn't realize. Was there one this morning? I don't know. Okay, so we're going to begin the afternoon session, and for that purpose, I'll ask Johanna Lodge Stair to come up, who's chairing the first part, and John James will chair the later part.
Thank you, Len, and thank you very much for the honor to co-chair this session on AIDS and having the opportunity to come back to the lab after more than two decades, almost three decades. I've been at the lab in the roaring 60s, end of the 60s, when we had still sit-ins in Stanford Research Lab against biological warfare, and we had free people, free music, lots of flower power, and a very colorful scene in San Francisco, a lot of gay, happy people, colorful dress. It was before the scene changed, and the people who know what I'm talking about, when the scene changed in the mid-70s to more black leather and chains and rings around all parts of your body, some parts of your body, then the bleak head of this monster was not, could not be seen, but it was already there, the HIV virus. And that's what changed the scene most. And now I'm going to introduce Mario, who's going to point us to a new paradigm of immunodeficiency in AIDS. But I don't know if we all are so sure about the old.
Thank you, Johanna. I'd like to discuss today some of the implications of the work that about half of our laboratory is currently involved in. It's a real pleasure to see the talks of this morning, and I'm sure the talks of the rest of the day and tomorrow about what people who used to be in the lab do, and this is a current view of half of our lab. I'd like to begin, slide projector, please. Can you turn on the projector? Just the power switch. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the extensive group of people who've been involved in the clinical study that we've been doing in Len and Lee's laboratory. Primarily, I want to acknowledge some of the people in particular, Ron Rabin, Bonnie Maldonado, and colleagues who worked on a series of pediatric HIV-infected patients, as well as a whole group in our lab who've worked on the adult study, together with Stan Derzinski and Greg Dubs. Greg has run our clinical trial up in the city. We're especially grateful to Tom Merrigan at the Stanford Center for AIDS Research for allowing us to use the facilities there, and Ernie Wong and Susan Wormsley for helping us considerably with the development of the antibody reagents that we've been using for this clinical trial. Now, I want to start just by giving a summary of what I'm going to try to convince you. And the data I'm going to show you is that all naive T cells are lost during the progression of HIV infection in HIV-infected adults as well as children. This is not only CD4 naive T cells, but CD8 naive T cells as well. And this was an unexpected finding, because no one had ever described a population of CD8 T cells that was disappearing in AIDS. What we found, in fact, is that both the CD4 and the CD8 naive T cells are lost progressively and apparently at a similar rate. And this might suggest that there's a common mechanism which accounts for the loss of both. As well, we now shown that the naive CD4 T cells are lost faster than memory CD4 T cells. And this is a change from what people had been presuming before based on inadequate data. And the, as is well known, the CD4 memory T cell counts decrease progressively while the CD8 memory T cells actually expand. And we'll touch briefly on what that might mean. Now, the implications of this change in representation, there are many implications not only for the immunopathogenesis of the disease, but as well for in vitro studies. Because a change in the representation of these functionally distinct subsets can lead to a change in the functionality of a bulk population of cells. Just by changing the representation of these functionally distinct naive and memory cells, you're going to change the apparent functionality of PBMC without actually having a change in the functionality of any particular cell. And I'll show some evidence for that. And I think what this leads us to is that we must reevaluate the existing in vitro data on the functional capacity of T cells from HIV-infected people. And in fact, many of these experiments will have to be redone with the ability to control for the representation of these subsets so that these assays are not just measuring the functional capacity of a bulk population, but really trying to address the basic question, which is, do cells in a particular subset change functionality? Now, this is one of my few fax plots that I'm going to show that describe the phenotypic subsets that we've been looking at to address the naive and memory representation in CD4 and CD8 cells. This shows progressively gated populations. If we look only at the lymphocyte population, we can discriminate on the basis of CD4 and CD8, the CD4 helper T cells and the CD8 cytotoxic suppressor T cells. If we then look at the expression of CD45RA and L-selectin, which is now known as CD62L, on these subsets, what we find is that there's at least 7 or 8 different T cell subsets. Within the CD4s, we see a predominant population which expresses both the RA and the L-selectin, and then at least 2 populations which are RA negative and distinguished on the basis of L-selectin. As well, there's a very minor population that's RA positive, L-selectin negative. In fact, in HIV-infected adults, this often becomes a predominant population here. In CD8s, we see a similar division, a major population which is expressing both of these markers, and at least 3 other populations expressing the other combinations. Now, studies that have been done in other laboratories have shown that this population, the L-selectin positive, RA positive population, is what we term naive T cells. These are the cells which have most recently arisen in thymopoiesis. They generally do not contain recall responses. This is the phenotype of the single positive T cells that are leaving the thymus. Whereas all these other populations are memory populations. These have been antigen selected to differentiate from naive cells. These populations contain the recall responses. And we can see that based on these plots, we can see why we need to do at least 3-color, simultaneous 3-color immunofluorescence to uniquely identify the naive T cells. Either CD45RA alone will not uniquely identify naive cells, nor will L-selectin alone uniquely identify this population. And incidentally, that's why what I'm going to show you, that this population is missing in HIV-infected adults, that's why this has been missed for 10 years, because this combination of markers has never been applied in a large study of HIV-infected adults. Now, what I'm going to show you in the next few slides is some of the preliminary functional studies that we have done, looking at what do these different subsets do, how are they functionally different. And when I go on to the clinical data, I want you to remember some of the some of the conclusions from the functional data and the implications that might have. Now, when we look, for instance, at calcium flux after CD3 stimulation, the ability to flux calcium is a prerequisite event leading to mitogenesis of T cells. It's a very immediate event that occurs after stimulation. When we look at the ability of these cells to flux calcium, we see that the naive T cells, the double positive cells here, double positive for RA and L-selectin, have a much stronger calcium flux in response to anti-CD3 and a higher sustained level of calcium after stimulation. Whereas the two memory populations have a much more mediocre calcium flux and a lower sustained level. This ability to flux calcium is specific to the CD3 stimulation pathway. If we use ionomycin to stimulate, to engage the calcium response, what we see is that at a variety of calcium concentrations, the three subsets of CD4 T cells have exactly the same capacity to flux calcium. So this difference here in the ability to flux calcium is indicative of different signal transduction capabilities within these cell subsets. They're very different functionally on a cell-by-cell basis. When we sort these cells and ask how do they proliferate in response to different mitogenic stimuli, we get results that go along with what you might expect from the calcium flux. That is, when you stimulate naive T cells with different conditions, say CD3 and PMA, or CD3 and CD28, what we find is that the naive cells in general proliferate to a much greater degree on a per cell basis than either of the memory subsets, and that there's considerable heterogeneity between the memory subsets in their ability to proliferate. And this is consistent with data that other people have been obtaining for the mouse system as well as the human system, that the naive cells in general proliferate much better than the memory cells. If we look at the cytokine production, again on a per cell basis, what we find in agreement with others is that there's a very different representation of cytokines. The naive cells, this is now for CD8 cells, but similar is true for the CD4s. The naive cells tend to make only IL-2 and perhaps GM-CSF. And other groups have shown that the naive cells make 15 times as much IL-2 as do the memory populations. On the other hand, the memory populations are responsible for making IL-4 or IL-5, gamma interferon. So the memory populations tend to make these more effector-like cytokines. The naive cells make the mitogenic cytokines like IL-2. Now, what does this mean in terms of the representation? Well, when we look at a variety of healthy adults, when four examples are shown here, what we see is that there's a variation in the representation of these different subsets. Some individuals have almost 75 or 80% of their, in this case, CD8 cells being naive. Others are down around 30 to 40%. But you can see that all of these healthy adults, irrespective of age, and the age range here is up to 55 or 60, have a considerable fraction of naive T cells in the periphery, in the peripheral blood. Now, when we looked at HIV-infected individuals, we saw a completely different picture. And what we saw is that the naive population is missing in a vast majority of the HIV-infected adults that we looked at. And in fact, in all HIV-infected adults, even those with relatively the highest end of this distribution, they were still at the very low end of the representation for uninfected adults. And this is CD8 cells now. So HIV-infected adults have a far lower representation preponderance of these naive T cells. And of course, therefore, they have a much higher representation of the different memory populations. When we look at children, in general, children are immunologically naive, or immature, I should say. And so the representation of naive T cells is very high. So typically, children have between 70 and 80% naive T cells, as measured by these markers. And you can see a very low proportion of the memory subsets. These are the plots that we were looking at before. When we look at HIV-infected children, again, we see a completely different picture now. What we see is a stark loss of these naive CD8 T cells and a tremendous expansion of the memory CD8 compartment, such that, in fact, HIV-infected children have less naive T cells than healthy adults. They have more memory T cells than do healthy adults. And you can see, again, this is true not only using L-selectin as a marker for naive and memory, but also if we use LFA1, the LFA1 dull cells are the naive cells. And again, you can see there's a significant loss of these cells and an overrepresentation of memory. Okay, so now let's bring these two pieces of data these pieces of information together. These functionally distinct subsets of cells and the significantly altered representation, and try to ask what is the impact on in vitro studies and what is the impact on immunopathogenesis. What I've shown here is the frequency, the representation of the different CD4 and CD8 memory naive cells amongst T cells from HIV negative healthy adults, and from the average for HIV-infected adults with less than 200 CD4s per microliter. And what we see is that in healthy adults, there's roughly 50-50 mixture of naive and memory for both CD4 and CD8. And of course, typically there are twice as many CD4s as there are CD8s. On the other hand, HIV-infected adults with less than 200 CD4s per microliter, 4/5 of their T cells are memory CD8s. So if you were to take a PBMC population from a person like this and a person like this and ask what sorts of cytokines are being made by these PBMC, or what sort of proliferation is going on, in this case, you're going to be measuring predominantly the capacity of these cells to function. And we know that the CD8 memory cells produce many more cytokines and much more of those cytokines. On the other hand, they proliferate to a much lesser degree. So in fact, the studies which have shown these sorts of results for HIV-infected individuals, we don't know if that's because there's an intrinsic change in the functionality of individual subsets, or simply an artifact, as it were, of the change in the representation of those subsets. So let me say that again. A specific loss of naive T cells from the periphery, from PBMC, or a change in the representation, a priori would be expected to lead to decreased proliferation, because those are the cells that have the good proliferation. It's expected to change the cytokine profile significantly. You expect to see less IL-2. On the other hand, you would expect to see more IL-4 and more IL-5, more gamma, and in fact, even more IL-10. And you expect to see more HIV replication based on some data from Fauci's group and more recently in our group, showing that the memory CD4s can support HIV replication itself much better than do the naive CD4s. So in assays of bulk populations, even purified CD4 or CD8 T cells, the extrinsic effect of subset representation may overshadow the intrinsic effect of difference in functional capacity. So I would argue that, in fact, the loss of the naive T cells may be responsible for apparent functional changes, such as an apparent change in the Th1-Th2 balance of cytokines. Again, you get an overrepresentation of CD8 memory cells, so you get an apparent shift in the cytokine profile from IL-2, predominantly IL-2 producing, to cells that will make much more IL-4, IL-5. It may explain increased apoptosis, because there's an increase in the representation of memory T cells, especially when those cells are activated, these are predisposed to apoptose. And in an interesting study that Peter Katsikas and Eric Wunderlich have been doing in our laboratory, looking at apoptosis, they in fact found that the spontaneous apoptosis, which has been shown to be elevated in PBMC in T cells from HIV-infected individuals, the spontaneous apoptosis is very well correlated with the frequency of activated memory cells in those individuals. Again, suggesting that this increase in spontaneous apoptosis is not necessarily related to a real change in the functional capacity of individual cells, but rather a change in the representation of cells which are going to do this anyway, whether they come from an HIV-infected person or an HIV-uninfected person. Now, what about clinically? Do the loss of the naive T cells mean anything for the immunopathogenesis in vivo? In our cross-sectional study, we found that in this case, for instance, this is the absolute naive CD8 cells per microliter of blood plotted against the total CD4 count. As many of you know, the CD4 count in terms of cells per microliter is the most commonly accepted surrogate marker for disease progression or stage of disease. And what we find is that there's a very good correlation between the naive CD8 count and the total CD4 count, indicating that as the disease progresses, as an HIV-infected person moves to less and less CD4s, they also have less and less naive CD8s. But it's not a perfect correlation. There are individuals who still retain quite a few numbers of these CD8 naive cells but have low CD4, and there's individuals who have very low CD8 naive but still have a lot of CD4. As well, we can show that the naive CD4 are preferentially lost to memory CD4, that they're the first to go. So we can speculate, why are the naive cells lost from HIV-infected individuals? Well, there's three ways to accomplish a change in the representation of cells or an absolute number of cells in the blood. One is to turn off the production. So either some sort of an event that alters thymopoiesis or the generation of these naive T cells. Now, it's systemic, so it has been shown by Mark Bonahati and Mike McCune that CD4, CD8 double positive thymocytes could be infected by HIV, and that would lead to their deletion. So it's possible that a high degree of infection of thymocytes would essentially turn off the production of new naive cells by deleting them before they can mature. It's possible that, on the other hand, there's no change in the thymopoiesis, but rather that in this highly inflammatory environment of the infected person, where there's a lot of stimulation, there's a lot of cytokines being produced, and the lymph nodes are highly active, that there's some sort of, there's an increased conversion of naive to memory. In fact, you would have to argue that it's an inappropriate maturation of naive to memory because it would not be antigen driven. Since 90%, for instance, of the naive T cells are being lost in these people, there's no way that they encountered all of the antigens that those 90% of naive T cells would see. So for them to all turn into memory cells, somehow there would have to be an antigen-independent way to mature these T cells into memory. And if that's the case, if that's what's going on, that's very important, because it means that in these individuals, there's a constant progression of naive T cells into memory, and there's a large number of essentially irrelevant memory cells that are flooding into the immune system. And to maintain homeostasis, the body has to eliminate some memory cells in order to keep the number of memory cells constant. And so naturally what will happen is that at occasion, the body's going to remove pre-existing memory cells, and you'll lose immunological memory. And certainly loss of immunological memory has been described for a long time in HIV-infected individuals. The last possibility is that these cells are specifically removed from circulation, some sort of redistribution event. Again, I don't consider this to be a very probable explanation, but even if it occurs, I would argue that it's very important. The whole function of the naive cells is to recirculate through the whole body to look for new antigens. And if they're being removed from circulation, then you're removing the ability of these cells to look for new antigens. So what are the T cell dynamics that we see in HIV disease? Well, all the naive T cells are progressively lost. Both CD4 and CD8 naive cells are lost prior or preferentially to the memory CD4 T cells. We all know that the CD4 memory cells are progressively lost as well, since the total CD4 compartment goes down. since naive CD8s go away, but memory, or the total CD8 count increases, this implies that there's an expansion of the CD8 memory compartment. But what we don't know is what happens to pre-existing memory cells. What happens to the CD8 memory cells that are existing in a person's body prior to infection with HIV 5 or 10 years down the line? So in a graphical way, these are the models that represent these dynamics. In CD4 T cells during progression, there's a continuous loss, very slow and steady loss of total CD4s. We know that the naive cells are preferentially lost, but even the memory cells disappear. In CD8 cells, on the other hand, there's an increase in the total number of CD8 cells, which remains until very late in disease. But there is, like in the CD4 compartment, an early and continuous loss of naive CD8s. So the question is, does the pre-existing memory, does the memory CD8 cells which exist at the time of infection, are these maintained throughout disease, or do they, like the CD4 memory T cells, disappear? And all you're left with is the memory cells that have arisen or expanded since infection, which are presumably specific to HIV or other opportunistic infections during this period of time. So I want to conclude by describing the immunopathogenic consequences of the loss of these cells for AIDS and for treatment strategies of AIDS. The loss of naive T cells implies a concomitant loss in the ability of an individual to respond to new antigens. Naive T cells are the requisite precursors for generating any new T cell response. So as these cells are progressively lost, there's going to be an increased susceptibility to infection, to opportunistic infections. Now, we know that immunological memory is lost in these individuals for whatever reason. But the problem is, as that memory is lost, they also are losing an ability to generate new memory, to generate primary responses. And that could account for this increase in opportunistic infections. But it's also important to remember that HIV itself mutates at a relatively high rate. And the new strains of HIV, of HIV variants, continually can arise in the body. And as naive T cells are lost, there's an inability to mount new responses to these variants. And therefore, during the progression of the disease, there's going to be less and less resistance of new HIV variants from the immune system. And this is what we believe underlies one of the basic underlying mechanisms of immunodeficiency in these people. Now, in terms of strategies for treatment, these are very important as well. There are very many, there are several companies now that are considering therapeutic vaccinations or immunomodulatory therapies. And we would predict, in fact, that therapeutic vaccination would fail in individuals who have no naive T cells. There's nothing there to respond to the vaccine. Immunomodulatory therapies, where you're trying to boost the immune system, perhaps to restore T cell generation, we have to understand why the naive T cells are lost. Otherwise, it will be pointless to try immunomodulatory therapies which are primarily aimed at naive T cells. The expansion, ex vivo expansion of specific CTL for reinfusion and treatment. Again, we need to understand where those CTL precursors are, in which of those phenotypic subsets, and what happens to them during the progression of the AIDS, of the disease. And so we hypothesize, in fact, we suggest that these clinical trials have to be done with the naive counts in question, rather than the total CD4 counts, which may be much less relevant to the progression of the disease. So the loss of these naive T cells, we don't understand why it's occurring, but we think it's very important to the disease. We think it's very important to the immunopathogenesis. And it's also very important and very central to understanding of in vitro data derived from these patients and decisions based on that in vitro data. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mario. Papers open for discussion. I think you were first.
The first question, in terms of transient activation, we don't see it because it's going through so quickly. In fact, I agree that that was the second hypothesis. But the problem is, if you've activated a naive T cell in an antigen-independent way, because there's not antigens for all your naive cells sitting around, does that naive T cell now become anergic or unresponsive, which it's predicted to be? So I would say that if that's happening, that's still equivalent. You're losing that functional compartment. Some studies have been done to look at, we haven't done anything with V gene usage, at repertoire in particular. And some attempts have been made, but nothing really striking has come out in terms of general repertoire.
Thank you.
How do you see your findings meshing with George Shaw and David Boisman?
Well, the question is, how do these results go along with what was recently published in Nature by George Shaw and David Ho, where they show what they call a 1 billion cell per day turnover? Now, those are very important papers from the virological standpoint. They're very interesting results. However, their interpretation of the cell number is way off base. Okay, they extrapolate from the peripheral CD4 counts to the entire body. And they say that when there's an increase in, say, by 20 or 30% in the number of CD4s per microliter of blood, that implies that there's an increase in 20 or 30% in the CD4 count of the spleen and the lymph nodes and the gut and every tissue. And that's clearly not the case. So they're extrapolating from the CD4 counts in the blood to the entire body, which just can't be done. Now, they certainly do show that there's a turnover, I believe, of 10 million cells per day from the peripheral blood. That's a number that I think is valid. But that's the kind of number which you would expect from the very long-term loss of CD4 cells over a period of 10 years. That's right in line with the number you would need to have to see that long-term loss. But I think their extrapolation to the billion cells per day is based on several unfounded assumptions.
Want to comment on this. I think you could easily measure with your method, find the patients who are on this new treatment of this protease inhibitor and just do your counts on the reappearance of a naive cell.
Absolutely. Had they phenotyped the cells, that would have given us a lot more information as well. The prediction, based on their hypothesis, the prediction is that all the new CD4s that have come in would be naive. And I don't think that's going to be the case, but that's...
Well, I was going to add that that's a testable hypothesis.
That's right.
But it seemed to be in their calculations, they pointedly ignored, in fact, the cell populations you've been carefully studying. And I'm curious how the half-life calculations they used in total body partitioning of CD4s and CD8s from your vantage point of looking at both naive and memory CD8s. What do you think the half-life of these circulating memory cells is? And is it that they are longer-lived cells
and
this is a survival mechanism?
There's a lot of data about half-life, and I don't want to get into it right now. We don't have any data that bears on that. But the other problem with their analysis was that they assumed one half-life for all of the cells, which we also know is incorrect. Excuse me.
Is there only one more important question? Which one is most important?
Okay. We can be more relaxed and ask a couple of questions.
Okay.
You suggest that the elevated CD8 memory population might be partially anergic. Has anybody looked to see whether it contains an autoreactive autolytic?
Well, actually, I didn't mean to suggest that it is largely anergic. The expanded CD8 compartment is probably largely HIV specific or OI specific, and I'm not sure that it's necessarily anergic. Now, one of the problems is that a lot of those memory CD8s may be specific to strains that no longer exist in the body. And so measuring their functionality or functional capacity is going to be difficult, inherently difficult.
Have you looked to see whether that's
No, we have not done functional studies on these cells from HIV-infected patients. We would love to, yeah, but we have not. We don't know the answer to that question.
Now, I have a question. You wrote in your biography that it's in this paper of all the nice data you showed is in publication. Yeah. And which journal?
Journal of Clinical Investigation.
Very good.
Thanks.
Thank you. Now, I would like to introduce Gary Nolan and his talk on RAL proteins and initiation of HIV.
So I have a couple of points of order after seeing Irv's talk this morning. I'd like to make the announcement that I own no equity position in any companies that might profit from my talk today. And second, somebody please make sure that Len's restraining straps are tightened another notch or two. Len wants me to say it again. Please make sure that we strap Len down. So it was as little as about 11 years ago that actually I arrived in the Herzenberg lab as a rotating graduate student. And it was not soon after Charlie Hsu and Jeff Dangle had thoroughly finished hazing me that Lee Herzenberg decided that I was too much of a filthy molecular biologist and I needed to get V to the mouse house and to learn a little bit of immunology. And so Lee sent me up to the mouse house. Those of you who are associated with the Herzenberg lab know that the mouse house used to be on the roof on the third floor, and so I tromped on up there to get some splenic cells. And it was a little while later that I called down to the lab to Timothy Gaddis to ask him a question, and which he answered, and I put down the phone. And then those of you who remember, there's an intercom system in the Herzenberg lab. And I soon heard over the intercom system my question being put again, correctly as I had asked it, which of the two spleens should I take, the left one or the right one? So Lee was correct. I did need to learn a little bit of immunology. And she, in typical Lee fashion, her encouragement was, Gary, it won't be the first stupid thing you do. So with that, if I can go on to the first slide, it has been a pleasure over the years to work with the Herzenbergs, certainly. And the first slide, please. Okay. And my interest in HIV actually grew out of interests which began in the Herzenberg lab. And it was Lynn and Lee's commitment to getting a handle on this disease and to make some sort of contribution to an understanding of the disease that led to my interest in transcriptional biology. I was interested in transcription all along. Lynn threatened many times to throw me out of the lab because of that interest, but eventually I came back to it. And the follow-up on studies of HIV in Lynn's lab led me to look into NF-kappa B as a short-term career, and now here at Stanford as a longer-term career in the Department of Molecular Pharmacology. HIV, as many of you know, and I'll talk a little bit about the role of NF-kappa B in HIV disease, HIV is a retrovirus in the classic sense. It has a dual lifestyle. It has both an RNA genome at one stage of its life cycle and a DNA genome later on. It begins life extracellularly. Here you have the lipid bilayer here, studded with the envelope proteins of a retrovirus. Inside is a capsid surrounding a nuclear protein core. Here, this is the RNA. There are two copies of the RNA for HIV and for almost any retrovirus. Okay, the progress of infection of a target cell by HIV or by any retrovirus is to come up next to some receptor protein. There's an envelope receptor interaction which leads to fusion of the retrovirus and insertion then or injection of the retroviral core into the cytoplasm of the cell. Here's where some of the most interesting aspects of the HIV transcription or retrovirology take place, where the RNA is reverse transcribed into DNA. Okay, and this is the reverse transcriptase protein, which actually carries out this mechanism or this biochemistry. The double-stranded DNA, which eventually forms from the RNA, then eventually makes its way into the nucleus of the cell. What's interesting about HIV is it's able to bypass the nuclear membrane of cells to insert into even non-dividing cells, which is unusual amongst retroviruses. Inserts into the DNA, which is what makes retroviruses per se so pathologic, in that they will integrate into the chromatin of the DNA and thereby take up residence in the chromatin. It's here that, to me, the interesting things begin. Because in HIV, it's here that it all begins. That to make the next stage of the life cycle, to reassemble new viruses, one must now transcribe the necessary proteins, transcribe the viral genomic RNA. Here are the proteins. Assemble now a new particle, bud out of the cell, to go on to the next stage of the life cycle. So as HIV is a long-term disease, as a lentivirus, and because it has a latent, or is thought to have a latent aspect to its life cycle, it's the events that go on here that will determine when these proteins are made and when the RNA is made as well. So we're going to focus in on that. Okay, so what are some of these early events? As I said, HIV is an integrated virus and integrates into the chromosome. So here, flanking these long terminal repeats of the virus are chromosomal DNA, essentially random insertion points from our standpoint. The long terminal repeats are where the regulatory aspects of the virus reside. Okay, up here is called an area called U3, which is the promoter enhancer structure. As many of you know, HIV has a very complex life cycle. First, it must make an RNA, full-length RNA. Depending upon the stage of the life cycle that the virus is in, whether the virus is thinking that it's latent or whether it's going to go active, the virus will either be spliced to multiply to form some of these regulatory proteins here, NEF, REV, TAT, and a host of others. I don't need to go into them now. We don't have the time. But eventually, a choice is made for making GAG, PAL, and ENV. Envelope, of course, GAG being the matrix proteins, PAL being the polymerase and integrase proteins. So choices made here, okay, the time at which the RNA polymerase assembles at this stage of the viral life cycle is what will drive many of these later events. There, of course, are the cellular events that must go on, but we're going to focus in here. So what is it here that goes on? What tells HIV to be on or off? Well, many years ago, it was suggested in David Baltimore's lab through the work of Gary Nabel that a protein factor called NF-kappa-B would bind to the enhancer region here, okay? And that it's the binding of this transcriptional regulator to this region here is what would initiate this event. So I got interested in NF-kappa-B and decided after I left Len's lab that I was going to study NF-kappa-B, and I determined that I was going to go off and try to clone it. So I'll tell you a little bit more about NF-kappa-B and what it is. There's NF-kappa-B, again, originally discovered in David Baltimore's lab and shown to be an important transcriptional regulator for a number of different genes. It's a transcriptional regulator for cytokines. It's a transcriptional regulator for a number of cell surface molecules, inducible and otherwise. It's a transcriptional regulator for a lot of neuronal genes as well, interestingly. Again, so this connection between the immune system and neuronal systems goes on. It was originally shown by Ranjan Sen to be a cytoplasmic protein here, 5065, that triangle there and this red oval. 5065 comprises NF-kappa-B, shown by Patrick Bowerly in the Baltimore lab. There's a regulator of NF-kappa-B, a cytoplasmic regulator, which will bind to NF-kappa-B, keep NF-kappa-B, I-kappa-B will bind to NF-kappa-B, keep NF-kappa-B sequestered in the cytoplasm, okay, and that in response to specific inducible signals, this is signals through the cell surface signals, intracellular signals as well. Many UV redox, changes in redox, et cetera, have all been shown to cause the phosphorylation and degradation, in that order now it seems from some more recent data, of IKappa-B, such that IKappa-B will disassociate, be degraded, will release NF-kappa-B, a nuclear localization signal is unveiled. It will then translocate into the nucleus, where it will bind to or near the regulatory regions of various genes, and thereby, through virtue of a transcriptional regulation domain, induce transcription as a typical enhancer factor, as it's thought. Now, the family of NF-kappa-B very quickly started to diverge and get interesting in that not only did you have a P50 component, 50 kilodaltons component, but also there's a 65 kilodalton component here, but that you would not only form heterodimers, but also you would could form homodimers of P50, so P50 homodimers here. As it's known now, P50 is derived from a larger protein, P105, which is processed in the cytoplasm, both constitutively and under inducible events, to form this protein, which will then translocate into the nucleus by itself to act upon different genes. Now, what's interesting is that depending upon the type of site to which it binds, and I don't have time to go into it today, it will either be an activator or a repressor. But suffice to say that there are multiple alternative regulatory modes for these REL proteins, and this is what we're going to explore today, showing that, in fact, these proteins don't just act. This thing, by the way, I should say, blinks by itself. It's not just my hand shaking. Okay. I don't know that there is one. Oh, is there? Uh-oh, I let Len up here. Someone let this... It's okay. No, I'm... Oh, that's much better. Thank you. Okay, thanks, Len. Len's right, as usual. That's okay. So, yes. So it's these differences that we're going to explore today and what how HIV has basically seems to unveil a new role for REL proteins beyond just the simple activator or repressor systems. So this is the family of REL anchoring proteins. It was very difficult for us to understand at the beginning how a single transcription factor could have roles in so many different expression of so many different proteins and genes. So 50, 65, here's 50, here's 65. So when I went off to do, I did my postdoc with David Baltimore at MIT and then at Rockefeller, I was, along with Shankar Ghosh, cloned 50 and 65, Shankar primarily 50, and then I worked on 65. What became apparent in the cloning of these genes was that, and then subsequent cloning of many other genes, that there was a family of transcriptional regulators which together, as hetero and homodimers, each interacting with the other in different ways, and there's some specificity involved in those interactions, comprised the family of NF-kappa-B regulators. So the DNA binding domain was found in this REL region, REL because there was a proto-oncogene called CREL, which was the founding member of this family, as VREL, as an actual oncogene in chickens. DNA binding domain here is about 300 amino acids. There is both a DNA binding and a dimerization domain. The recent crystal structures show actually that the dimerization domain can also contribute in some ways to the DNA binding. So for the standpoint of what are our interests right now, the REL region is what we're interested in. And specifically, I'm going to talk about P50, and its which is just from this here to here. The processing event is right here, which releases P50 homodimers, and P52, which is a homolog, a gene very similar, I think about 80% or so homology. These are the regulators, the IKappa-Bs. Here's IKappa-B alpha, all right? IKappa-B alpha has this series of what are called anchoring domains, which are protein-protein recognition domains. I did some work on BCL3 as well. I'll just tell you, IKappa-B alpha recognizes P65. BCL3 specifically recognizes P50 and P52. And BCL3 will regulate the activities of these two proteins when they're bound to DNA. IKappa-B alpha regulates the activity of this protein when it's in the cytoplasm. So the family has multiple distinct roles, some things acting in a nucleus, others acting in a cytoplasm. And so the regulation, as you can see, you can very quickly build up a very complex regulatory structure with just a simple set of genes like this. I'll mention just briefly NFAT. NFAT, discovered in Jerry Crabtree's lab, is also a REL protein both by virtue of the fact that it has significant homology, and also that if you look at the intron-exon structures of NFAT and compare them to the intron-exon structures of these proteins here, the intron-exon boundaries match, proving then that there has been evolutionary divergence from a single ancestral gene, but I won't go into that. But right now, what this says is that knowing the importance of this protein that Jerry has shown quite nicely over the years to immune system biology, knowing the importance of these says that we're talking about a very important family of proteins here. Okay, so this is my one immunology, pure immunology slide. We're talking here about HIV, remember, and we're talking about HIV infecting both T cells and macrophages. These are, for me at least right now, the interesting cell types. REL proteins play roles up and down throughout these cell types during differentiation and during the specific activities of these cells, as demonstrated, in fact, by the two knockout papers in Cell this month from the Baltimore lab and from Rodrigo Bravo's lab of P50 and REL-B, but I won't go into that, but there's some very nice papers there. So HIV infects these cells, so what are the roles here for HIV, and how do they interact with REL proteins? So this is the enhancer region, the enhancer promoter region of HIV. All right, here's the classic NF-kappa B site, okay, upstream. These are the sites that Gary Nabel recognized some years ago. Okay, this is the SP1 site, Tata here, which attracts TBP. And then transcriptional initiation begins here. Everything about HIV starts there, it has been thought. Okay, so this is the important aspect. And what I'm going to tell you today, in fact, so the conclusion of what today's talks are, of today's talk is, that we found that there are new NF-kappa B sites down here, which sit on top of what are known to be initiation sites, or this initiation site here. A discovery, if I get to it towards the end, of a new initiation site in HIV down here, which you think has some role for production of TAT. And the protein and the proteins that that P50 or that some REL proteins might be interacting with here, and how this changes the regulatory our regulatory picture of how HIV operates. Okay. So, before I even go on. So let's start with this. For many years now, it's been understood that HIV has just these two NF-kappa B sites. The classic and the classic paradigmatic consensus site for NF-kappa B is this sequence here, GGG, AC, TTT, CC. And for many years, it's been thought that this was an NF-kappa B site with some variations. You can put N regions in here. But this is what it's been for many years, and this is what people have thought and searched for in other genes. All right, so the studies here begin with a graduate student by the name of Monty Montano, who was in Len Herzenberg's lab at the time, when I was still back in New York. And Monty and I were setting up to do some projects on what we call the dialectic of, this is a typical Montyism, I think, the dialectic of HIV-REL interactions. How does HIV affect REL proteins to affect its own regulation? Okay. And so what we started was the view that we knew very little about the HIV enhancer region, and what, can we get an idea of what types of transcription factors might be binding here? And Monty set up a very interesting survey using the computer program. And he asked, let's not look just for consensus sites. Let's make the assumption that consensus sites are getting broader as we discover new sites in genes. So let's write the computer program in such a way that it searches beyond the known just slightly. Let's not go looking for anything. Let's just go perhaps one or two steps beyond the known. And what showed up was right at the top of the list, and that surprised me. I remember when Monty called me and asked me about this, the possibility of this being a site, was that, in fact, these two sites here, which look very much, if you compare the sequence here, they look very much like NF-kappa B sites. So we then began a study of these sites to ask, do they bind REL proteins? And what role might they have, then, if they're sitting right on top of transcriptional initiation in the regulation of HIV expression? So these are now gel shift assays where you radiolabel the target DNA, you take nuclear extracts from a cell, you bind those nuclear extracts to that radiolabeled protein, and you run it out on a polyacrylamide gel. That DNA which is unbound is here. That DNA which has bound a specific protein will supershift or will more slowly migrate through the gel. So this is the standard assay for NF-kappa B. Here you have an IG-kappa B site. This is the GGACTTTCC site here. This is now in Jurkat cells. Uninduced, constitutive, if you remember, you have P50 homodimers. Induction gives you this band here, 5065, in addition to the 50 homodimers. Now, taking both what we call the TAR kappa B and the initiator kappa B, so those two sites which we recognize, and they're both just the TAR one, which was the downstream one, we find that there's a protein which binds at a place similar to P50, or it looks like it migrates in a collinear fashion with P50. It's a bit darker here. But specifically, though, we don't see the 5065. So the inducible protein, if this is in fact, if these are in any way rel proteins, are missing in this assay. 293 cells show the same thing. This is a fibroblast line. Okay. So what was interesting about this then was that not only could you see a protein which looked like P50, but that you were specifically missing one of the family members which are normally induced with TNF. All right. So this was the first type of site that that is known which has this type of property. So the question is this truly P50? The answer is yes, that when you use purified protein, and I don't have time to show that, purified protein recapitulates this answer, not just taking total nuclear extracts, but now using purified P50, we would see binding similar to this. Okay, but 5065 is specifically excluded. All right, so that was the first interesting aspect. So the proof was that it can bind, all right, using purified proteins, and that there was something interesting about the heterodimer. Now, in those nuclear extracts, is that truly P50? If you use antisera to P50, shown here, taking that nuclear extract now and using antisera to P50 to supershift, in fact, you specifically supershift using P50, but using control antisera, you do not. But notice that the entire complex is not supershifting. In other studies where we've cross-linked the proteins that are bound there, there are actually two other proteins that we don't know the identity. There's a protein of about 40 kilodaltons and a protein of about 70 kilodaltons, if I remember correctly. So, but we do know that a subset of the proteins binding are P50 that are binding downstream now, which is very different than classical understanding of regulatory elements. There are regulatory elements downstream of transcriptional initiation that appear to involve rel proteins. So what might they be doing here? So when molecular biologists see transcription sites, they immediately run for their transfections. And that's what we began with. So this here, and I apologize for the slide not being quite up to par, but this is supposed to be a plasmid which has the regulatory region of HIV here. In this case, it's the SF2 region, the SF2 strain, or ARVZ strain, and driving a reporter gene, in this case, LACZ, or secondarily, another reporter gene where the upstream NF-kappa-B sites have been deleted and shown to specifically deplete NF-kappa-B activation through these sites. So what did Monty do? He took these plasmids here and co-transfected them along with the cloned genes of the rel of different rel family proteins. And let's just focus here on the top one. Here's the basal transcriptional level. When one puts in P52, as one might expect, shown by Gary Nabel, after he cloned P52, that you get some modest activation. Putting a little bit of P65, you also got modest activation. But the two together, and we can get even better results than this, will synergize as NF-kappa-B, as a heterodimer. And this can be quite nicely shown, formally shown. So this is the known and previously published result. But what happens if you remove that upstream kappa-B enhancer? Well, you certainly ablate, as one would expect, activation by the heterodimer and by 65, but interestingly, 52 still activates. Okay, so that rel proteins still have activity even though you have ablated what is thought to be the canonical site. Okay, the same thing works for P50 as well, but I'll just use P52 as an illustration. So what we've shown through a lot of data, and we're quite convinced with it at this point, that you will get P50 and P52 binding down here at these two initiator sites, downstream of what's previously thought of as being the known sites. So why are you getting transcription? Why are you getting binding at these transcriptional initiation sites downstream? What's going on here? And why is P50 binding here? What might it be interacting with and what might it be doing? Is it a repressor, an activator, neutral, what have you? TF2D, this is I'll talk about in a moment. So we need to get into some real biochemistry here for a moment. What happens when you initiate transcription? What sort of complexes are forming at the start sites of genes? All right, we know about Tata. There are Tata elements to which TF2D will bind. All right, there are also proteins called, or regions called initiators, which are important. Both of these elements can be used by genes either independently or together, some genes have both of these, to attract TF2D, which is the starting point for transcriptional regulation. So one way that this can happen is that TF2A, a protein known to many of the transcriptionologists, will bind first, attract TF2D, will bind, and then this will initiate transcription by recruiting RNA polymerase, and then enhancer factors will interact with this and will fire transcription at a rate which might be expected from the power of the enhancer, or the strength of the enhancer. Another way shown in Bob Rader's lab by Ananda Roy is that another protein can bind down here, and this is what happens with HIV, a protein called TF2I. TF2I binds and attracts TF2D. TF2A is not required. So there are these two different ways that you can get what are called pre-initiation complexes. Now, TF2I is binding in the same region that P50 is binding. So what's going on? So the way to look at this now, this is the region, okay, that we're talking about. This is the NF-kappa-B sites here. Okay, those are the new sites, TAR and INR-kappa-B. The consensus for these initiator proteins is this. Starts around here, a little bit and overlapping the initiator kappa-B and the TAR kappa-B sites. So there are two sites. The TF2I requires this part of the region here, and then it's overlapping the REL region or the REL binding sites here. These are some other initiators that are known. So TF2I is known to bind here. It's an HLH protein. USF can also bind here, but let's focus on TF2I and what its role might be here. It's known to be very important for HIV transcription. Okay, so what happens when you have the two of these proteins together, REL proteins and TF2I? Okay, so this is, again, a gel shift assay. And we look to see, are P50 and TF2I acting together? Are they repressors? Are they coactivators? What are they doing? So in this lane, in these boxes, you can see TF2I. We're adding very minimal amounts of TF2I, I should note. So even though you can't see it on this gel, in an overexposure, it's there. But adding in and asking, what happens if we add a little bit of REL P52 or P50, where we add 1 unit, 2 units, 4 units, or two? So here, let's look in the last lane, P52 alone. Okay, so these are, this smear up at the top, don't pay any attention to. This is P52 itself. This is a degradation product of P52. Okay, so here you see just P52. But look at what happens when both REL and TF2I is there. You get a dramatic augmentation of the binding of TF2I. So if you add in just twice as much here of the TF2I, of the P52, you get almost a 3 to maybe 4-fold increase in augmentation of binding of TF2I. So the postulate would be then that if TF2I is important for transcriptional regulation of HIV and REL proteins binding here can vastly augment the binding of TF2I, then REL proteins, by in and of themselves, must have or could have some very positive role in stimulation of transcription from HIV's initiator, not as enhancer factors, but acting prior to the formation of the pre-initiation complex, which is a very novel role for REL proteins indeed. So this is now another version of this, also showing that P50 will do the same thing and that it requires a REL binding site for the augmentation. So it's not just adding P50 per se, but that you need a REL binding site on which this can land. So here is the minimal levels of TF2I binding. Here's P52, okay? Here's P50, we didn't even add enough to be able to see. But here now when you have both P50 and TF2I, look at the size of the band, look at the increase in the augmentation. The same increase in augmentation is not seen when we use another type of site which can be bound by TF2I. So here's TF2I alone. Here's adding P50 or P52. There's a slight augmentation, but nothing near like what is observed here. So this event, this augmentation of binding, is not just P50 contributing some steric role in the absence of the DNA, but that it appears to require P50 binding to the DNA at some point, or P52 binding to the DNA at some point, and then then drawing in TF2I to increase its binding. Okay, so I showed you some other data a moment ago which showed the transcriptional data by transfections. Many people know that when you do transfections, there are a lot of indirect effects that can occur. We were interested in seeing whether we could reconstitute this in an in vitro system. This is now HeLa in vitro nuclear extract. So this is, again, Monty's work now in my lab as a postdoc. And so what we're looking at here is a template, all right, where we've deleted or made inoperative the upstream enhancer. And now we're asking, what is the transcriptional ability of this template in the presence of additional rel proteins in vitro in your HeLa nuclear extracts, which are going to supply all the necessary goodies, but now we add in additional P50 or P52. Okay, in this case, it's P52. So here's the basal level of transcription. And so again, this is RNA now that we're looking at. And this is a measure of the RNA transcription events occurring at this at the +1 start site. In the presence of P52, you can see that there's an augmentation. This is about a 3 to 4-fold augmentation, which is what you would expect from the transcription studies where we did the transfections. Okay, but look here. Now, this is the proof, and this is what got, I think, fairly excited, that you can't just add something and then say, well, it had an effect. You have to specifically have some way of depleting what it is that you've added after you've added it to say that if I specifically deplete that, it's not something else that I'm putting in with the mixture that is causing the effect. So here again is where we have the enhancer minus template. There's the basal level. Here's the addition here, where there's, again, about a 3 to 4-fold increase. But then in this last lane here, okay, we'll add in kappa B oligo. This is DNA binding site, which should soak up the available P52. All right, and it's in the soaking up of the P52 that we would hope to ablate the increase, and in fact we do. All right, so there's not something that has co-purified with the P52 or some non-specific rel factor, whatever it is, binds to the kappa B oligo. So we're fairly convinced at this point that what we're seeing is a specific effect of the rel proteins binding here, and in some way augmenting what we think the binding of TF2I and transcriptional initiation. Again, the major point here is that we're having rel proteins that appear to be acting downstream of transcriptional initiation, which is very different from what people used to think of before, and acting what we think is pre-formation of the initiation complex. Okay, so that's what I'm showing here. I'm coming to the end of the talk here. We think that there really is a division of labor of rel proteins on the HIV promoter, one before initiation begins, one after initiation begins here. We think that there's a conspiracy or an interaction of the P50 and P52 through binding of proteins at these sites here, and that P50 and 52 in some way augment the binding of these sites. So again, there is a dichotomy in what is going on. Rel proteins aren't just acting up here, but there's something else going on down here. What's interesting to us is that when you look in a number of other genes, the same type of regulatory motif seems to apply, that a lot of other genes known to be regulated by NF-kappa B also have sitting right on top of their initiation sites, NF-kappa B sites that everybody ignored because they're always looking upstream. Okay, I mean, it's a surprising result to me, at least, that people had been missing that. So here's the model, finally. We think that HIV transcription in some way is being regulated by rel homodimers binding at initiator regions prior to formation of anything at the TATA, and that in some way the rel proteins are participating in assembly, early assembly, by recruiting TF2I, and that the gel binding studies, you might have noticed that there wasn't any additional complexes of just rels and TF2I both co-binding, but that the gel binding studies seem to imply that P50 exits the complex, okay, or P52 exits the complex after TF2I binds here. TF2I, again, through the studies of Rader et al., then recruits TBP, TF2D, then some activation event in the cell activates rel heterodimers to bind upstream to interact with TF2D, and then gets the initiation complex turning into an RNA polymerization event eventually. So how much time do I have, Lynn? Do I have a... I'm way over. Okay. Then I will just move right through those, dun-da-da, and I'm done. Thank you very much. Yes, I think that the two parts are important, and what I didn't get a chance to show you at the end there was that there appears to be a second transcriptional initiation site downstream of the first site at plus 32, and that we think that it's the interaction of rel proteins at these sites, and we have some data that I didn't get a chance to show, which is determining which of the transcriptional initiation sites is being used. And we don't have any formal proof of that. That's just our expectation at this point. And why that's important is because you have to ask the question, how does it all get started? Where does a protein called TAT come from? You might know TAT binds the TAR loop, right? If you have to get the TAR loop being bound by TAT, and then that then allows for progression of the RNA polymerase through the rest of the genome, where does TAT come from in the first place? So if you start downstream of plus one, somewhere in the middle of the TAT-TAR stem loop, then you can't form the stem loop. And that if you get transcriptional initiation starting there, then that can be where some of these regulatory proteins get their genesis.
You said that you now see these other NF-kappa-B sites in other gene systems. Mm-hmm.
You find both types, in fact. You find some that look like things that people would have previously missed, and then there are some that are so blindingly obvious that I can only be paranoid and imagine that people have seen them and that they're working on them. Okay, thank you very much. I know that I'm well beyond my time.
Thanks, Gary. And I should introduce John James, who's not been a member of my lab and not been anything but a friend of the lab and a friend of the last several years. He is the editor and publisher of AIDS Treatment News, a very useful newsletter for scientists as well as non-scientists interested in the AIDS problem. And I recommend it highly. It's available in my lab and several other labs around Stanford, and I imagine lots of other places. It must have a pretty good circulation. I think the newspaper people use it as well as professional scientists, and it's extremely authoritative. John makes it his business to go to as many scientific meetings as he can and to talk to people directly who have made the findings which he's going to report about, and so therefore he does get a very accurate representation of the information. I also think you must have a pretty good staff because you couldn't do it all yourself. But he is going to introduce Laurie Garrett, who's the next speaker, and I'll just let him do that and say anything else you'd like to for 2 minutes.
Well, I'll just introduce Laurie Garrett, who's for many years been a well-known science writer and AIDS reporter, and also is recently the author of the book, The Coming Plague.
Thank you. I have an airplane to catch, and we are running about 45 minutes late, so I'm going to have to go very fast. I'm going to have to be cutting the talk as I go, so in the words of the immortal Betty Davis, fasten your seat belts, we're in for a bumpy ride. Also, since absolutely everybody's made reference to the first time they ever met Lee, I'm sure she doesn't even know about this because we weren't introduced at the time. I was very young. I was visiting my brother, who was older than me and attending Stanford as an undergraduate. And we were walking through past the math building here on campus, and there was a screaming argument going on with a huge crowd. And on one side of the screaming argument was this tiny woman standing next to this big guy, Lenny Siegel. And on the other side was this huge guy from the Revolutionary Union. And they were having a screaming fight about whether or not it was proper to throw rocks at the math building because there were rumors that they were doing mathematical modeling for the CIA. Lee was, of course, opposed to throwing rocks. I'm not a scientist, as you probably all know. I'm a journalist. So on the downside of that means my credibility in a room as august as this gathering is low. But that gives me an advantage. I can speculate wildly. You expect nothing less from me. So with nods to Lee, happy birthday, McFarlane Burnett, Rene DuBose, Francis Black, William McNeil, Richard Levins, John Cairns, Thomas McCune, here I go. Ever since I wrote this little ditty, I've been on the talk show circuit, and I don't know how many of you have ever had that experience, but it is by and large pretty strange. You get a lot of hosts saying to you, I haven't had a chance to read your book, we're about to go on the air, tell me what questions you want me to ask. You think I made this up? But every now and then you get an intelligent host, or at the very least, some intelligent member of the audience. And when that happens, one of the most common questions that comes up is, what about human immunity? Because my book is about newly emerging diseases and the potential for very serious newly emerging diseases in our future. So those members of the audience who hope, have been frightened by the discussion and hope that there's some out, say, but won't the human immune system kick in? If not for the individual, at least for the population, won't there be herd immunity eventually? So therefore, our species will survive. We have nothing to worry about. Somehow the T cells, the macrophage, the B cells, the antibodies, the cytokines, everybody's going to muster an attack and the herd will survive. And certainly those are, that's a basic assumption of most undergraduate biology teaching. The herd will survive. Sort of a dictum of evolution. It must have be able to survive because here we all are. But now here we are 14 years into this pandemic of AIDS. And within 5 years, we will cumulatively have 30 to 40 million AIDS cases, or excuse me, HIV positive individuals on planet Earth, according to the World Health Organization, or 38 to 120 million, according to the Harvard-based AIDS Policy Coalition. We should be honest, nobody really knows exactly how many we're going to have, but whatever the numbers, they're frightening, they're horrendous, they're inexcusable. In the U.S., as many of you may have heard, AIDS is now the number one killer of adults of both genders aged 20 to 44. That's not number one disease killer. That's number one over suicide, over homicide, over car accidents, and over every single disease. In sub-Saharan Africa, of course, HIV is the number one killer of people of both genders aged 10 through 55. It would probably be to an older age group as well, except that life expectancy is overall low. So here we are, 14 years into the epidemic, and we're only beginning to identify subpopulations of the HIV-positive population who seem possibly to have effective immunity to the virus. They fall into two groups. One are the long-term non-progressors. We don't know their prognosis, to be honest. We don't know if these people we call long-term non-progressors, which are defined differently from one lab to another, unfortunately, and there is no uniform definition, but let me, for the sake of argument, say people who've been HIV positive for 10 years without any serologic or symptomatic changes from basic healthy adult. We don't know whether these people are truly controlling the virus and truly will never come down with AIDS, or whether they represent the far end of a natural history curve and will eventually develop AIDS, only in their case it will take 20 years instead of 5 or 6 or 8. They could just be on that side of the curve. That's the glass is half empty possibility. On the other hand, their bodies might be mustering an effective response. It might be something like the George Shaw, David Ho model, only in this case, as David Ho called it, the sink with the drain open while the faucet is on full. That was his analogy for what's going on with the immune system of HIV-positive people. Maybe in these people, the drain is stopped up. Who knows? But there are a handful of people identified in various cohorts around the world who actually seem to have either cleared virus or to have been repeatedly exposed and never infected. They are a variety of different groups of these people found. One of the most striking groups is a group of female prostitutes in Nairobi who are daily exposed, often multiple times per day, to HIV-positive men, and no, they don't use a condom every time. And yet, they have remained absolutely HIV negative, in some cases, despite 8 years of known daily exposure. There's also a cohort that's been studied by people at the NIH who are intravenous infected lab workers, needle stick injuries and so on, who are known definitely, it's clear they were exposed, yet they have never seroconverted, and not only not made antibody response, but no PCR recovery of virus has been made. And then there are some individuals within large cohorts of gay men in the US and France in particular, where there are those who believe that some of these individuals have cleared virus. I believe in Los Angeles it's 3 individuals, and similarly low numbers elsewhere in the United States and in Paris. Combined, the long-term non-progressors and these mystery cases represent at most 5% of the world's current HIV-positive human population. That's the rough estimate made by multiple sites, Tony Fauci, David Ho, Roger Dettles, and quite a number of other groups. So 5% doesn't sound like herd immunity to me. It would be difficult to argue that we have evidence for a population-based significant immune response to this virus. Which is curious because the state of the art in clade genome analysis of HIV and of its simian cousins, SIV1 and 2, indicate that HIV is a very old virus. It's not something that just suddenly appeared on the public health landscape in 1975. It has been around for a long time. Beatrice Hahn at the University of Alabama has demonstrated that SIV1 African green monkey is definitely as old as the African green monkey species itself. It also, in the SIV2 model, depending on which monkey derivative one looks at, they also appear to be quite ancient viruses. And SIV2, HIV2, appear to be very close, in some cases, for some subtypes, identical viruses. The oldest PCR-proven HIV1 found in the world dates to 1959, Manchester, England. David Ho has completely PCR analyzed it. It is a bona fide HIV1, and it is coincident genomically with the current B clade dominant form we find here in the United States. We don't have anything older than that, and that's probably not because it wasn't there, but rather because we really don't have any good blood and tissue samples from any sort of mystery death cases that were saved all this time for analysis. Los Alamos National Laboratory, a GenBank group, Jerry Myers group, has done significant genomic analysis of now, I believe it's 160 different strains found around the world, and been able to figure out longevity of these strains and based on relatedness. And he's concluded that HIV-1 is hundreds of years old. And then the most striking sort of historical search was done by Joe McCormick and Kevin DeCock. Joe had been one of the lead investigators during the famous Ebola outbreak in northern Zaire in 1976. He was one of the people who went into Anzara and also Yambuku to try and figure out what was the cause of this mysterious epidemic and stop it. And he and other members of the international team took hundreds and hundreds of blood and tissue samples at that time. For 10 years, they sat in freezers in Atlanta. And then McCormick, when HIV began to spread more rapidly around the world, said, I wonder if by any chance. So he thawed the samples from 1976, northern Zaire, a very, very remote, sparsely populated area, and found out that 1% of them were HIV positive. So he sent Kevin DeCock back to northern Zaire, to the same villages, to the same population groups, retested the population. And then Kevin did a smart thing. He went towards the Congo River from Yambuku, and then down the river, stopping at every one of the bars, brothels, and pit stops that the traders will go to as they go up and down shipping their cargo on the river, and tested population groups there all the way to Kinshasa. What did he find? The rate of infection in the Yambuku area is still 1%. As he moved to closer and closer to Kinshasa, closer and closer to greater human density, to more and more prostitution, the rate of infection soared until in 1986, when he did the study, they were looking at 55% infection rates in the female prostitutes in Kinshasa. These things imply two things. Though HIV is probably a very old virus and has probably been at some very low level in the human population for a long time, it has only recently in human history found the proper social and behavioral situations to allow its emergence on a significant scale. And the second lesson is that there doesn't appear, despite the fact that it's ancient, to be a significant population or a pocket of population anywhere on the planet of people who are immune, who have, shall we say, memory cells that say, I recognize what this is and I shall destroy it. So that's HIV. A lot of people, when I raise issues that I'm trying to raise in my book and use HIV as the example, immediately kind of close their eyes, nod out, and go, HIV. Because most people, at least here in the U.S., like to think that HIV is somebody else's problem, not their own, and that they can comfortably ignore it because they're not at risk. So let's look at something that everybody kind of does find scary, even if they've not had any reason to confront it in their lifetime or their parents' lifetime or their parents' parents' lifetime. Yersinia. The first known outbreak of Yersinia pestis was in 1346 in the Mongolian steppes. We're not exactly sure why it showed up that year, but there are some historical data and some speculation that the weather patterns were unusual that year. Very, very heavy snows in the Mongolian steppes, which, as those of you who are ecologists know, in heavy snows, rodents burrow underground and actually reproduce at a higher rate. Whatever the case, there were historical reports of huge vole and wild rodent populations on the steppes, and with that, presumably, large flea populations. The Yersinia pestis spread originally along the caravan routes down to China and then India. And of course, once you had a critical number of humans infected, you had no more need necessarily for the flea vector because you could have pneumonic transmission. Once Yersinia pestis reached India and China, we don't know exactly how many people died that year because databases are sparse. But anecdotal reports were of whole cities devastated. And China's own very meticulous census data, which was ordered by the emperor once every set of cycles of the animal years, however you call that, showed that in 1200 AD, China had a population of 123 million people, but by 1393, its population was only 65 million. By the time Yersinia pestis reached Italy aboard a ship landing in Sicily that presumably had infected rats, it spread very rapidly through the Middle East and Europe. By 1350, 30 million Europeans had perished, more than 35% of Europe's entire population. The highest tolls were taken in the areas of the greatest human density. So, cities. London lost 52% of its population in 4 months. Hamburg lost 50%. Bremen, 66%. The epidemic did eventually die down. What we don't know is why. Again, going back to Bio 101, most of us were sort of vaguely taught the survivors were immune. But we have no real reason to think that that's necessarily true. It's there are other things that are much more likely immediate explanations. For example, there could have been an enormous, and probably was, an enormous rat fall, taking away the primary reservoir. Behavior certainly changed. People fled cities. People went out into the countrysides. On a massive scale, human density decreased, so the odds of transmission pneumonically went down. We certainly know that the reason it stopped completely after its reappearance 300 years later in 1665 in London, after killing 40% of the population in 4 months, was because fire broke out and London burned to the ground. And along with it went the rats and the fleas. Outbreaks have continued to reappear, though. Yersinia, when it appears, when it has an opportunity to really take hold in a population, continuously, well after 1665, would claim as many as 40 or 50% of a targeted population. Some of the most horrendous outbreaks occurred during the Hajjs in Mecca. And, of course, India suffered a devastating plague epidemic between 1880 and 1920. Conservative estimates are that 20 million people died. So, again, if we ask when a disease emerges, when a microbe emerges into a population, when does herd immunity kick in? In the case of Yersinia, we have to ask how much of the fact that these plagues stopped was due to behavior, how much was due to the die-off of the rat population, the flea populations, and how much was because there was some nature of human immunity that took hold so that the survivors were immune to the microbe. Another example to turn to might be the Columbian era Amerindians. William McNeill, whose book Plagues and Peoples, if you have not read it, should be on your immediate, sometime this week, required reading list, estimates that between 1492 and 1502, 25 of every 26 Indians in South American urban centers perished due to infectious disease. Francis Black has estimated that there were about 70 million Amerindians from Alaska to southern Chile, 56 million of whom perished in the first decade after the arrival of Columbus. Death was primarily due to smallpox, influenza, yellow fever, measles, TB, rubella, and pertussis. And you can only imagine how it must have seemed to the Native Americans when all of us, first these strange white people with these weird Cortez uniforms come walking in, and then everybody around you is dying of things you've never seen before, you can't imagine. It might go a long way to explain why everybody became Catholics. The interesting thing is that people think of this as, all right, the survivors were the immunes or something. What were they? But they survived. There was this small percentage that survived, and that's the end of the story. But it's not the end of the story, because, in fact, the die-off due to particularly acute susceptibility to introduced infectious disease is continuing in Native American populations. By 1930, by Francis Black's estimations, the North American Indian population had plummeted so far down that it was only 3% of its 1492 level. Now, of course, some of that is warfare and starvation, but disease is the major player. Similar tolls were taken among Asian Pacific Islanders when Europeans first visited Hawaii, Tahiti, New Guinea, etc. But with the exception of the Hottentots, there was no analogous mass wipeout produced by introduced organisms in Africa. Why? Francis Black argues that genetic diversity is the key. He says that studies of contemporary Amazon Indians he has conducted, where die-off is still continuing due to introduced disease, show that if you look at unvaccinated individuals living in the deep in the Amazon, their die-off rates due to exposure to visiting European descendant individuals are exactly analogous to the die-off rates seen after the arrival of Columbus. However, if you vaccinate them to each of the targeted diseases, their survival rates are the same as their European counterparts. He's calculated that HLA diversity is extremely low among Native Americans, Pacific Islanders, and the surviving Hottentots. It may be because the migrational flows of human beings that originally went to each of these destination sites were very small numbers of people, so that virtually every Native American is descended from two waves of migration across the Bering Sea, which each of which involved relatively small groups of people. One estimate is fewer than 20,000 individuals. According to Francis Black's calculations, a microbe passing from one individual in Africa to another individual in Africa has a 0.5% chance of encountering the same MHC profile in each of the two individuals. But among Amerindians, the odds are 32%. Now, the significance of this was heightened and became sharply clear when Abbey and Guerin did their studies in West Africa with measles. This is very recent work, just in the last 6 years. They've been studying measles dynamics mostly in Senegal, and it was primarily because the World Health Organization was very concerned that the key die-off due to measles, which continues to be the number one pediatric killer in Africa, occurs in the very first months of life before traditional vaccines can even be administered. So WHO was trying to come up with a vaccine that could be administered at an earlier stage. They came up with the Edmonton-Zagreb vaccine, tried it out on a large scale in Senegal. Guerin and Abbey were doing the social demographics of the targeted populations, the controls and the recipients. They found two things that were really stunning. First of all, if they followed the recipients of vaccine for 3 years, they had twice the level of die-off due to all infectious diseases combined compared to the vaccinated individuals, though none of them died of measles. Nobody knows why. WHO initially refused to believe this and refused to withdraw the vaccine. It led to huge fights. A subsequent repeat trials in Haiti and Ghana proved this to be absolutely true, and Edmonton-Zagreb vaccine is not used in this child population. The second thing, though, that they found that was even more intriguing involved the control group. When they looked at the village level at the control groups and followed measles outbreaks when they occurred, they discovered something very curious was going on. If you took the index child, the first child that in the village that came down with measles, and then followed each of that child's housemates, whoever lived in that hut with that child, and family contacts, there was a very striking pattern. If you say that the index case had a mortality index of 1.0, that child's cousin had a mortality index of 1.9. That child's half-sibling had a mortality index of 2.3. And that child's full sibling had a mortality index of 3.8. What they concluded from this, and then subsequent studies in Haiti and elsewhere have reached similar conclusions, is that the virus was adapting to an MHC presentation, and that as it saw siblings with the same MHC profile or similar MHC profile, the virus was capable of overcoming their immune response more readily. So you might construct an argument from this that would go back to these people that are initially, you know, calling in and asking me questions on the talk shows and saying, what about human immunity? And you might say, well, the good news is, you know, we're more heterogeneous now. We migrate all over the place. We intermarry. We're breaking down ethnic and racial boundaries. So we're going to have these great jumbled HLA profiles and MHC profiles, and therefore we'll be less vulnerable to mass devastation by introduced microbes. Perhaps. But that ignores human behavior, which in many ways may have more to do with the rapid spread than anything that's going on in MHC, HLA, and your immune response. There's a bunch of very strange and troubling things going on in the world right now that need to be considered in this. For example, there is a huge diphtheria epidemic underway in Russia right now. It's massive. I mean, the data is very hard to obtain on the numbers of cases because, as you probably all know, the Russian public health system has entirely collapsed. But WHO was estimating last year alone there were 10,000 hospitalized for acute diphtheria in Russia. And the year before, some 6,000 or 7,000. And it's just soaring this year. The interesting thing is the majority of the cases are adults who were immunized for diphtheria. It's now clear in study, further study, and the British government has concluded clear enough that they've basically instructed that all British citizens traveling in Russia or Ukraine must be revaccinated for diphtheria. But they've basically concluded that vaccination provides waning immunity, and that that we can no longer assume that diphtheria vaccination in childhood is lifelong protection. The other thing, of course, is that all of this couldn't have happened if it hadn't been for behavioral circumstances in Russia. Namely, in this case, it broke out in the Moscow train station because hundreds of thousands of impoverished Russians have been descending into the train stations in St. Petersburg and Moscow and so on, thinking that they're going to find homes and work, and discovering that there's a housing shortage in all the cities and there's no jobs. And they end up living in the train stations, one on top of the other. And it's in these settings that multiple re-exposure to whatever wild-type diphtheria may be out there in a handful of children that perhaps have slipped through the public health vaccination net in the post-Gorbachev era are sparking epidemics. Malaria is another curious case that we have to come to grips with immunologically. It is spreading. There are more people coming down with malaria and dying of malaria today in the world than ever before in world history, despite powerful drugs, despite pesticides that can control, or we think ought to be able to control, the mosquitoes. And we're seeing very rapid strain variation in the malarial populations, particularly falciparum, with very strong drug resistance profiles, including the presence of a pump system in some strains that, like a chemotherapy pump in a cancer cell, will just pump out anything you throw its way, so that there are no effective therapies, particularly in Thailand and Cambodia, for these particular strains. When we look at that, we have to really ask the question, are there people who are actually immune to malaria? And I think if one is very honest about the data, the answer you have to come up with is no. There are people who develop a state of chronic infection with the microbe under control, except for those days when they suddenly develop soaring fevers and have to take a few days off of work. But immune, able to walk amongst malarial mosquitoes with impunity, no. In fact, there are now very striking studies coming out from particularly from Thailand, but also from various parts of West Africa, that show that the strains of parasites will vary according to neighborhood within a given city. That the genomic profiles of these parasites will radically vary, and that your susceptibility and your ability to withstand infection or to control infection will vary if you even just move within the same city. Influenza is another one we have to come to grips with. There's no evidence that in any major influenza pandemic in world history, there's been a pocket of immunologically advantaged human beings. There have been pockets of behaviorally advantaged, but there's no evidence that anywhere in the world when influenza appeared, there were pockets of humans that were capable on a population level to demonstrate rapid herd immunity. So, and in fact, I noticed this morning in Max Cooper's talk about the chickens, I was going to ask him, I know that influenza's major reservoir is birds, and the major way influenza gets around the world is on migratory bird paths, and most wild birds are able to carry it like a harmless reservoir situation, but domestic chickens get wiped out completely. There have been massive wipeouts, 90 to 100% of chicken populations in certain poultry farms when exposed to the bird droppings from wild migratory birds, and I just wondered if there's anything about inbred domestic chickens and their immune systems that might explain that. Anyway, so what is herd immunity? I don't really think anybody knows. Paul Fine argues that the level of population immunity necessary to protect any given population group from widespread epidemic spread of measles, for example, is almost entirely dependent on the social setting. So that what your definition of effective herd immunity will be in Iowa will be totally different from Harlem. And in fact, we saw that with the epidemic in 1990-91 of measles in New York City. We only had to see a 5% drop-off in vaccination rates in children in Harlem and the South Bronx for us to have a citywide epidemic of measles. So I go back to the question, what about the human immune system? Can we say, for example, in the case of HIV, can we predict that somewhere down the road, 2 human generations from now, 3 human generations from now, the percentage of the human population that can be classified a long-term non-progressor will be larger? Is that an inevitable trend? Will there, instead of 5% now being apparent survivors / long-term non-progressors, would it be 20% in the year 2050? I doubt it. I think that that the bottom line here, you just keep coming back to behavior. I have to tell a quick anecdote. Do I have time? Very quick anecdote. I was recently in India looking at the AIDS epidemic in India, and I happened to be there when the plague broke out, so I dashed up to Surat immediately to get in the middle of the plague. And the fascinating, utterly fascinating. And the city was largely deserted. The folks that were around were all wearing their little masks, which were either handmade or things they got from some local health authority. So people were on their mopeds with their little masks on. Everywhere all over the city, there was a sense of, this is an abnormal situation, we're all scared, we're taking appropriate measures to protect ourselves, until you started heading to the epicenter of it all. Which, to get to the epicenter, where it all started, the worst ghetto, the worst slum of a city that is basically one giant slum, you had to go down a street that was the red light district. And there, all the women, of course, did not have their masks on, because how are they going to attract customers? That did not amaze me. It did not amaze me that in the middle of the plague, the women, whose survival is dependent on turning over a certain frequency of customers every day, would not wear a mask. What amazed me was they had customers. We're in the middle of a pneumonic plague epidemic, and these guys couldn't wait. So you talk about herd immunity. The heck with herd immunity. It's behavior, 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 behavior. If you can't stop, if you can't get people to think about a mask and pneumonic plague, you're not going to get them to use a condom. And in fact, if you look around at sexually transmitted diseases, I would defy you to name herd immunity phenomenon in any major sexually transmitted disease. Gonorrhea? Have you ever seen it? Any evidence for it? Syphilis? HPV? Chlamydia? Candida? Anybody got any evidence for herd immunity? I don't think it exists. Finally, I just have to close with one of my favorite Joshua Lederberg quotes, because he was going to be with us here today, and I understand he was unable to make it. In remarking on this whole phenomenon at a meeting in Washington, Josh said, well, we have to understand that we are locked in an evolutionary struggle with our microbial predators, and whether Homo sapiens will survive is not preordained. Thank you. I think maybe I could have time to take one or two questions, and then I got to run to the airport. Johanna.
A person who has lots to do with bacterial and viral immunity, so it was a big, very interesting mix-up, but I just want to point on one of your very, very interesting examples. The bubonic plague, the pneumonic plague in India, this isn't true. This has never been proved that this is a pneumonic plague. So this. The CDC has decided that this is just a media bubonic plague.
Well, I saw people dying of plague in the hospital, so I but it is a subject to a great debate because the Indian laboratory that was responsible for assessing the samples was in New Delhi, and it was, well, to just give you an idea of the status of this laboratory, I walked right into it, was standing in the middle of it before I realized that I was in the plague laboratory. In other words, no security, no sense of a particularly dangerous organism anybody was working on, and it really looked to me like a high school lab. And this was the facility that was supposed to isolate Yersinia from the samples. And unfortunately, they did such a bad job, most of the samples were devastated, and it was not possible to recover Yersinia. In India, there was a very immediate response from the Hindu language newspapers, vociferous response, to say there was no plague in India, that this was all a fabrication of the Pakistanis who were trying to bring down the Indian economy by getting the Gulf states to embargo the nation. And I don't think we'll ever know the exact answer, because the CDC itself, I have spoken at length with those people involved in the investigation, and they said that the samples, it's just not possible to say yes or no, was there ever Yersinia in India. But there certainly was a mass die-off and a mass illness due to something, because I saw the patients.
But not a bubonic, you are a living example that it's not bubonic.
I don't know, I was prophylaxing with tetracycline myself. Anybody else? Sure, and there's politics involved in the decisions of many leaders of communities in Europe to decimate Jews in order to stop a disease. Lee. Happy birthday again.
So we do have a coffee break. I don't know if we have time for it, but we're going to have one. So we're going to have 15 minutes. Please come back in 15 minutes. That means by 4:25.